It was March the 13th, and I came across an article in the Baltimore Sun written by the guest joining me here in studio, Luke Broadwater, and it had to do with the University of Maryland Medical System and its board members being able to get contracts from the very entity they were overseeing out of this 30-member board. And one of the names on there was Mayor Catherine Pugh. And it intrigued me so much, I called Luke, and he came on the very next day, on that next day, March the 14th, and we talked about the story. And I had no idea, when we were talking about it, the different areas, the reach, the tentacles that this story would have, including the resignation last week of Baltimore City Mayor Catherine Pugh, and the article that came across this weekend where we go inside the home, the Ashburton home, once again, a block away from where I live, right around the corner of Mayor Catherine Pugh. Luke, good morning. How you doing?
Hey, doing well. Thanks for having me.
Look, let's start from the very beginning. And I heard you talking about this on Friday with Euripsy Morgan, but it's very important to keep repeating this. A lot of great stories like yours, I mean, when you look at what it's become, they start off with a tip. You got a tip to look into this.
That's right. Senator Jill Carter called me from West Baltimore, and she said, Luke, I have a complaint in my district. A minority contractor is having trouble getting work with the University of Maryland Medical System. It was actually a very informal conversation. People have tried to make it seem like this was a formal complaint or something in retrospect, but can you look into it? I think there's something going on with this board. Things don't seem to be above board, et cetera. So the next day I reached out to the University of Maryland Medical System and I asked for all their board members' names, what kind of contracts they had, how much the contracts were worth, whether they were bid or no bid. And they told me they weren't going to give me any information. And so I said,
that's not good for not-for-profit.
So I said, okay, you know, let's see about that. And so, you know, it took me two or three days to track these documents down. I had to call around. I had to dig a little bit. And finally, I got my hands on them. And I think it was the day before Senator Carter's legislation was supposed to have a hearing. And I'm flipping through the documents. And I said, oh, my God, the mayor's in here. And I called her up and I said, did you know the mayor was in here? She said, she said that was news to her. She was completely unaware of that. And we published the story and then, you know, all hell broke loose.
Everything went to meetings in Annapolis with the governor, with the Speaker of the House, late Speaker of the House, Mike Bush, to President of the Senate, Mike Miller. We saw legislation passed that eliminated, got rid of the entire 30-member board. There's an audit going on now, the University of Maryland Medical System. Subpoenas, as you reported, have been issued on the University of Maryland Medical System. I'm going to get back to the mayor in one moment, but just based on where your reporting is going with this, How are they going to select this new board? Where's this new board coming from, at least as far as you know, how this is going to happen?
Well, the governor is going to appoint it. The board members right now have to resign in three different segments. They don't want to dissolve the whole board at one time because they have to continue to run the hospital network. But a third of the board has to resign by July, a third a little bit later, and then a third by the end of the year. So Governor Hogan's going to have a chance here to completely remake the board. He told me, actually, when I saw him up in New Hampshire, that he wanted a completely overhauled board, nobody returning. we'll see if a few people can survive. You know, not everybody on this board is accused of self-dealing.
Right, right.
Two-thirds weren't. But, you know, I think he feels like you really need a clean start here just because of, you know, how
now, let's remind people the significance of this is even though the University of Maryland Medical System is a not-for-profit 501c3, a private entity, they receive tens of millions of dollars from the taxpayer state of Maryland for great work. They do great work, but the taxpayer dollars, that's why I wanted to make sure people understand. A lot of taxpayer dollars.
Oh, yeah. And it's important to remember this started as a public hospital.
Right.
It was privatized in 1984. It still receives a ton of taxpayer support and money. I think there's actually like a $50 or $60 million project in the capital budget for the University of Maryland Medical System right now. So, yeah, your tax dollars are going to support
exactly
this network. So it is important that every dollar is spent wisely.
Speaking of that, how unique is it, and when I say unique, I don't mean that in a good way, that we hear the University of Maryland Medical System is asking for a 5% hike in rates while we're examining these potentially no-bid contracts going. I would say a bit of bad timing.
It's a very high hike comparatively, 5%. So patients will be seeing, if this goes through, patients will be seeing their bills go up. And I think that's part of the outrage here. The reason Senator Carter put in her bill to begin with about banning no-bid contracting, what she said to me is, if board members are getting hundreds of thousands or millions of dollars in deals for their own companies that may or may not have been bid out appropriately and the best value, that's going to trickle down to the ratepayer. So when you go to get your
whatever procedure, your surgery,
your checkup or whatever, and the bill comes back, maybe it should be 10% lower or 20% lower. So
Just very interesting timing about this right here. I wonder who pitched that. He must have the size of grapefruits. But anyway, Luke Broadwater is here in studio with me from the Baltimore Sun columnist. His March the 13th article set a lot of things in motion. Let's get to the article you wrote over the weekend as we have gone through now to the point where the mayor has resigned. And what you talk about in this article are the days that she went through with friends coming by, State Senator Joan Carter Conway, who they served in the state Senate together. Then you talk about people like Dr. Tyrone Powers. Talk about a little bit what's behind in that house going on during this time.
Sure. So, you know, a lot
when
of
the mayor, I'm sorry, when the mayor takes leave of absence. Anyway, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah. So the mayor went on leave on April 1st. We haven't seen her publicly since then. And so there were a lot of questions.
Since the press conference that she had.
Correct. So I think everybody remembers that.
By the way, that QVC Healthy Holly line is coming through anytime now.
That really wild press conference. I mean, it was a surreal moment in Baltimore history. I'm never going to forget that thing. But the my editors asked me, can you find out what it was like inside the house, what was going on in there, and what her decision process was like? And obviously, I haven't been able to get in contact with the mayor since this whole thing happened. We used to actually talk pretty frequently. So I talked to the people who visited her, to the people who had been in contact with her on the phone or either in person, and went through her mental processes. And it was interesting because apparently right up until the FBI raided her house, she had hoped to come back. So the day before, she was even saying she wasn't going to run again, but she was going to come back and serve out her term and, in her view, do all this tremendous change in her final year that she hadn't been able to get to. And then the FBI raided her house, and it was sort of a very clear message to her and her lawyers and her advisors that it was time to step aside.
You also write in here that Judge Andre Davis, city solicitor, had actually presented her with a letter of resignation prior to this the second letter of resignation, right?
Yes, that's
right. The second letter.
Yeah, Judge Davis told me that. He said, you know, it wasn't the first letter we sent over, Luke. Because he was concerned there was this idea that you know, she wasn't of sound mind when she signed it. Maybe she did it under
the rest,
while right. She wasn't lucid or something. And he wanted to make it clear that no, like we sent one over earlier. She did not sign that one. Now she had gotten to the point with her reasoning and her thinking that it was time to sign it. And, you know, speaking with Dr. Powers, who was with her the day of the resignation, that she had actually wanted to give the speech herself to resign. But she didn't look well enough to him. So he told her not to do it. But she had wanted to go out and talk to the public herself, according to him. So I wonder when that day will come. Now, her lawyer says she's a private person now.
Sure.
She may not ever want to give a speech like that.
Right.
But there are a lot of people who want to hear from her after all this time.
Well, there's still a state special prosecutor investigation going on. There's, of course, the FBI and IRS and what they're doing. And I've never shared this before, but I feel comfortable doing it now that the mayor is no longer mayor. But I talk with the mayor, and I would occasionally talk with the mayor, totally off the record. And I talk with the mayor prior to her going into the hospital. And I was concerned then, Luke, before she went in with pneumonia, and a lot of people I talked to were that she was very, very desperate, that there was a desperation in her voice on multiple levels, that she was feeling under pressure to a large extent. And I'm not going to share the total contents, but the whole thing was she seemed very, very desperate at that particular time. Reading your article, I can pick that up, that there's this air of desperation around her throughout this entire time.
Yeah, I think that that's probably a fair summation, because she was not under the problems with her physical health, with pneumonia and bronchitis, but also this intense emotional stress. And all her friends and advisors that I talked to said this was really preventing her from getting healthy. She was under just tremendous emotional stress.
And she was saying things like, people are out to get me. Like you even write it here in your article, like somehow the power structure had turned on her.
Yes. Yeah, and I mean, you know, in some ways it's hard. It would be hard for her, you know, her actions aside, obviously
right.
She did what she did. But hard for her not to conclude that when you have the entire city council calling you to resign,
Baltimore
the governor.
I mean, the GBC.
Yes, the business community, the House of Delegates. You have
the Baltimore Sun. Put it out there.
Baltimore Sun editorial board. You have seven different investigations: FBI, IRS, state mm-hmm. prosecutor, ethics board, inspector general, Maryland Insurance Administration, internal audits. I mean, it goes on and on. There's this tremendous public pressure on a person to resign. And I mean, I don't know how you would have to be inhuman not to feel some kind of way about that.
Well, since you have opened a door into a whole world that a lot of people are looking into now of self-dealing and arrest that, when the FBI put out those billboards asking for tips on public corruption, that's not just on Mayor Pugh. I've had a lot of people call my show, Luke, and say, look, Mayor Pugh, of course, is going to face what she faces, but there were 8 other people making, you know, money with these contracts, and who knows how many other people involved with these types of things. Without, of course, I'm sure you're doing research. A lot of people are saying there's more than Mayor Pugh here.
Oh, absolutely. And I think you've already seen a lot of fallout. I mean, it didn't get as much attention because he's not as well-known person, but the CEO of the University of Maryland Medical System also had to resign
over
this.
Walked away from a $4 million salary.
Yes, $4.3 million a year. You know, he's not as high a profile figure, but he had to resign as well. The 7 different board members have taken leaves, 3 resigned.
Including former state senator Frank Kelly. He served with my father in Annapolis.
Yeah, executive compensation was frozen. The raises, big bonuses for the executives. The Kellys and their sons took leaves of absence from all the board of directors, from all the various hospitals. The entire board has to resign. There's emergency legislation that passed. And I think we're going to continue to see more fallout. I would not be surprised at all if we don't see the legislature come back next year. And they did a reform bill on UMS, but look to reform other public-private institutions and other nonprofit boards throughout the state.
Based on your reporting, what have you seen? Because a lot of people are suggesting that the investigation of the FBI and IRS really, it might be Healthy Holly a little bit, but it started long before the Healthy Holly situation, that there might be other things going on with the feds.
Yeah, that's correct. So through our reporting, we know from several sources that the federal investigation predates the state investigation, which was launched in response to our reporting. According to these sources, that investigation dates back more than a year. Now, I don't know exactly what they were looking at.
I don't know
how that one launched. We do know that there were allegations about Mayor Pugh's conduct during the campaign and shortly thereafter with Gary Brown, one of her top aides, being charged for illegal campaign
contributions. He was actually on his way to being sworn in as a member of the House of Delegates and had to step down because of this.
That's right. And then Jim Smith, one of her top aides, was fined for an illegal last-minute loan of $100,000.
Former Baltimore County Executive Jim Smith.
To Mayor Pugh. There were allegations that she, from the Sheila Dixon campaign, that Mayor Pugh had paid for votes through food and jobs and busing people to the polls. There was a great deal, 66,000 or more checks that bounced and seemed to come from fictitious or made up companies and people. So there were a lot of things that could have prompted this investigation. I don't know what it was. There was this nonprofit she was involved with, MCAT,
right,
that got raided during the raid. But we do know from the FBI's actions that there seems to be some crossover, because they were carrying out Healthy Holly books from her house. Right? Boxes and boxes
so
of the books.
That's just so bad, yes.
We do know that they subpoenaed the University of Maryland Medical System for evidence, documents, and testimony as part of their investigation. So there definitely is some crossover here. What's the old saying? When you kick up a hornet's nest, ain't telling.
You never know where else going to be there. You never know.
Ain't telling who's going to get stung.
That's right.
So this could go anywhere. I mean, this could. We know they've raided other properties in town. So, you know, it may be the mayor and maybe others.
Well, that's the thing. When I see a billboard like that, Luke Broadwater from the Baltimore Sun, who joins us in here, I think that they're soliciting information on others. And when I say others, I don't know who that may be. In the last couple of minutes we have, Luke, we've seen the city now. We talked about the state response. The city council introduced at least 7 different pieces of legislation going to ethics, going to changing the structure of city government. Just based on what you're hearing from council members, I think this shook up City Hall. They want to change how they oversee each other.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, there seems to be a great desire on the city council right now to weaken the strong mayor system. That the strong mayor system
I've been screaming about this for years.
Maybe was something that was good a century ago or something, but in the modern era, it has not benefited the city. This is their point of view. So that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to take steps to weaken the mayor, put more checks on the mayor.
Have a process where you can get rid of a mayor short of conviction. Because without a conviction, you couldn't get rid of the mayor.
And a lot of the mayor's power stems from her complete control of the Board of Estimates, which, you know, hands out all the contracts, and then her complete control of the budget. So she really controls all the money, he or she, whoever the mayor is. And then, you know, and so in their view, that makes the mayor ripe for targeting from the business community.
Absolutely.
If they're looking to
get favor,
cut a $100,000 check or a $500,000 check
to get $48 million in return
or whatever, that's the person you go to, because there's one person who really controls all the purse strings, and they think if power was disseminated more or spread out more, then you'd have less issues. That said, you could also have more people who are open to the business community.
Well, I don't know if you found this to be the case, Luke Broadwater, but I have seen with Mayor Jack Young coming on board, more communication from the mayor's office, more transparency than I've seen in a long time. So I don't know whether or not it's been a shock of God into it, but I get something every day. I'm sure you do too.
Yeah, no, I think all of us in the press corps certainly enjoy the fact that Jack Young's office is putting out a daily schedule where he's going to be every day, keeping in constant contact. And we hadn't seen that from Mayor Pugh. So at least in his dealing with the press corps and with the wider public, the new mayor already is taking a bigger stand towards transparency.
In the meantime, Luke Broadwater, we have a 1- and 2-year-old shot on Friday. That's the backdrop to all this. And the incessant crime continues. Luke Broadwater from the Baltimore Sun, great job reporting this. I wanted to get you in, my friend. And been a long time since the Baltimore Examiner days, huh?
We had some good times back then,
back
didn't
at
we?
Night. It was on 9 to midnight. Actually, we had to bring Luke and Stephen Janison here from 9 to midnight. But anyway, thanks a lot, my friend.
Right, thank you.
Thanks for coming in. Stay here.